Good morning. Good morning. Thank you, Neil, and thank you, Leslie. As Neil said, and the program indicates, this panel will be discussing the issue of technology and culture, and it's a pleasure to have helped to coordinate this panel and to be here with our distinguished panelists. Robert Darton, Harvard's head librarian, will speak about the future of the book in the digital age and about the tension between maintaining broad access to information sources and commercial interests that want to monetize that access. Bob has been outspoken about the impact of Google's plan to digitize books, and he became a fellow of the Academy in 1980. David Ferriero is the archivist of the United States. He will be speaking about how digital technology affects our ability to archive history, and in turn, what happens to our collective memory in a digitized world. He was inducted into the Academy yesterday. And Marjorie Scardino is the CEO of Pearson LLC, an international media company with leading businesses in education, business information, and consumer publishing. The Pearson media empire spans from the Penguin brand to the Financial Times, which is noteworthy for its success online as well as offline. And she'll be sharing her thoughts about how digital technology has affected the media in general and publishing specifically, and how shifts in media brought about by digitization are changing how the information needs of a democracy in the internet era are being served. And she was inducted into the Academy yesterday. More than a billion people now around the globe access the internet on a regular basis. So as we think about the impact of technology on culture and perhaps about the impact of culture on technology, here are a few developments to keep in mind. If websites and countries were ranked by population, then Facebook, with now about 500 million users worldwide, would be number three behind China and India and ahead of the United States. E-book sales today represent still only about 1% of book sales worldwide, but Amazon recently reported that its e-book sales now lead hardcover book sales in the United States. Consumption of video in the home over the internet is still only about 1% of video viewing in the home. And it took 15 years from the introduction of consumer broadband services to get to this 1% mark. But only in the past few years has the average home in almost every developed part of the world been able to access the internet at speeds capable of supporting video quality that equals television. So just this summer, for example, the BBC reported that 5% of World Cup viewing on television in Britain was done over the internet, five times the average. And that was for an event that was on free TV in every pub, not to mention every home in the country. We can and will talk today about the risks of all content being digitized and controlled by a few centralized entities, public or private. But it's also true that digitization of records and access through the web has given more people access to more information than at any time before, at least for now. And soon that access, even if it becomes more limited in some ways, will be accessed by more people using mobile devices than by personal computers, and that means access to information is about to expand globally to levels that have never been seen before in human history. And at the same time, we're seeing that this flood of digital information is not washing across the landscape in an even manner. A year ago, I served as a member of the Knight Commission on the Information of Needs of Communities in a Democracy. And we held hearings across the country, and we took testimony from a very wide array of groups and individuals. And we concluded that the time had come for some new thinking and aggressive action to improve the information opportunities available to the American people. We wrote a year ago that America is at a critical juncture in the history of communications. Information technology is changing our lives in ways that we can't easily foresee. And as dramatic as the impacts have been already, they are just beginning. The digital age is creating an information and a communications renaissance, but it is not serving all people and certainly not all Americans and local communities in an equal way. And it's not serving the democratic process fully. How we react individually and collectively to this democratic shortfall will affect the quality of our lives and the very nature of our communities. And as humans, we have some habits that are hard to break, and some of these are very useful because they create patterns that we can recognize and they help us sort out our world. So as we turn to Bob Darton, we should consider what happens to our view of trust of what we see and what we read and what we hear. It's one thing to examine a scientific text, for example, to hold a researcher's logbook in our hands, but what happens when that's transformed into bits that can just disappear online or perhaps be changed without our knowledge? So Bob, welcome, and you could get us started. What happens not just to our notion of the library and the digital future, but to our notion of access to information?